Number 15 of Law and Grace, or Law and Lamb, and tonight's class will end this quarter. However, I'm going to continue for another semester after this. Alrighty, let's turn to the book of Matthew. We're going to go to Matthew 4 right now. We want to look a little bit about the law. Jesus mentions it here. Or at least alludes to it. He does mention it in chapter 5, but the Lord speaks in different ways. He doesn't speak in the same way that modern Christianity speaks. He, for example, and some of the scriptures we'll look at will examine this thought, but the thought is that the law is a shadow. The law is a shadow. And as such, I think that, number one, that's hard for us to comprehend. In fact, you know, keep your place here, and I think that we can find that in Hebrews 8, if I'm not mistaken, where we can just read it and not assume that I'm making up stuff. 8. Yeah. Hebrews 8, 5. It's talking about the priests that are after the Aaronic priesthood, the priesthood of Aaron, who serve and did the example and shadow of heavenly things, as Moses was admonished of God when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, saith he, that thou make all things according to the pattern shown to thee in the mount. All right, so he was in the mount. He was with the Lord. He saw the Lord. He didn't just get a teaching. He saw the Lord. And that was the pattern from which this shadow began to be cast. That was the material thing. It was God himself. That was the substance that was substantive enough to cast a shadow. Okay, but this says that the shadow is the law, that it is the law. And there's other places in Hebrews, several different places that say the same thing. So a lot of times in the New Testament, when it talks about coming out of darkness, it's talking about coming out of the law per se. Let me just give you an example of that. Well, first of all, it's the most easy one. If there was a bright light over there and it was darker in the room and I stood here, my shadow would be cast over there. We would call that a shadow. Okay, now, same principle, so follow me. If the sun is over there and the earth is right here and the sun shines on the earth, then everything out here that would show that would be not a shadow, but we would call it darkness. Right? Darkness. Because it's not the exact image. It's not the exact image of God. It is a shadowy, dark picture that has no life and no substance and no reality. It is as if a lamb walked in front of the light and it cast a shadow. If I could draw that real quick, I would draw a lamb walking. I'd draw the sun here and a lamb walking in front of that, and the light hitting the lamb and the shadow that would be cast, I would just draw it with chalk in the form of Ten Commandments. But better. I mean, that does give you the idea that the law is a shadow, right? But better, 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 much better if that light shined on the lamb and the shadow it cast was, love the Lord thy God with everything you got in you. Love your neighbor as yourself. Don't steal from your neighbor. You know, be a blessing to your neighbor. Just going through all of the things that the law requires. It would cast that, that would be the true shadow of the lamb. It would be the true picture. And so we would look at that and we would go, this is wonderful. These ethics are high. Or we wouldn't use the word ethics. This religion, these statutes to follow, they're so missing the express image, the exact image being a shadow and not the very image. And so the law, and so this is the way God sees it. Okay, so this is what I'm trying to get at here. This is the way God sees this, and this is the way Jesus sees it. So when he speaks in Matthew 4 and 5 and 6 and 7, when he speaks, it sounds simple to us, but it's not simple. It is profound. You know, I remember when I was in Bible school, I used to say, I would share something or see something, and I would go, this is amazing. It's so simple, but it's profoundly simple. And then I said, which makes it simply profound. It's amazing. And the Lord is amazing. And he should be amazing to us, and he should be amazing at all points, not just when he amazingly does something for us and we go, yes, I went to church and you wouldn't believe what happened. What happened? Did you see God? No, he saw me. He noticed me because I was doing this. Look here. You see, supposed to be hands worshiping. Yeah. Some of you know what I'm talking about because you have been in services where somebody came who would give words of wisdom or prophetic words, and you would kind of, they'd call, you know, or they'd have everybody stand, and you would kind of go, you know, to some action, something, to go, notice me and then give me a great word. You know, if the true word of God was really given more often, they wouldn't be so cheery. You know, you would be hiding. you know. I mean, he's very sweet. Look at the book of Revelation, you know. You have this and you have this, but I have somewhat against thee. Oh, it can't be too bad. You've left your first love. Oh, whew, I thought it was something bad. Oh my God. See, we're so insensitive, and we're insensitive on a regular basis. And so the Holy Spirit continually never gives up, does he? That's the beauty of the Holy Spirit. He never gives up. And but that doesn't mean he always gets through. Amen? Come on. Because we can get so insensitive that we're, that he stands at the door and knocked, and, you know, we don't even hear the knocking. But anyway, off the track a little bit there. So the law is a shadow, and so the shadow is as a lamb that would pass in front of the sun, the light, and it would cast these, instead of an outline of a lamb, it would cast the outline of love God with everything you got, or love your neighbor, or it would be that, and we would see the incredible value of the shadow instead of the nature that cast that. So, did we read here in Hebrew? Yes, we did. Okay, so let's go back to Matthew 4. And I want to show you some of these things where, as I said, a shadow is, we call it a shadow, but it's a darkness. And when the earth casts a shadow, we call it darkness. Because the earth is standing, as it were, in front of what God wants. And that's the true spirit of it. That may not work out astronomically. I almost said astrologically. It doesn't work out according to, you know, how we look in science books and whatever, but it works out according to God's understanding. And here's an example. We're in Matthew 4:16. The people who sat in darkness saw great light, and to them who sat in the region and shadow of death, light is sprung up. Okay? So he is proclaiming not necessarily the way everything has happened, because everybody at this juncture barely knows him. He's just stepped on the scene. But he proclaims this in terms of reality of his heart and the way he sees things. When we see him, and we see by light, and he is that light. That's everything from Jesus, I am the light of the world, I am, all the way down to the book of Revelation. In that place, there will be no light, for the Lamb is the light. Okay, and that's the fulfillment of it, the fact that it's come to fruition in us. When I say fulfillment, that it has come to fullness in us as reality and working in us, not fullness of knowledge. Book of Revelation is not like the Book of Romans. It's not a book of knowledge, if you will. It's a book of bringing into manifestation, when it deals with the church, that lamb nature. So, let's look at another one over in Luke chapter 1. Verse 78, Luke chapter 1, verse 78. Through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high hath visited us to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace. Okay, so this is Jesus, and the child grew and da 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 da. This is his purpose. He didn't come to merely save us from hell. He came to, let's see, I've got it here, and I'm wondering if I should go to that now or not. And it looks like maybe not. So we'll hold off on getting into that. But I will say this, that his heart in sending his son, and the son's heart in coming, was ultimately fulfilled again by Book of Revelation at the end, when it's no longer the churches meeting in Smyrna and, you know, all these different locations. It is that which is with him above that is willing to come back down, having his glory and not their own glory. And her light is the Lamb in her, because that's really what that's talking about in the Book of Revelation. The city, New Jerusalem, the wife of the Lamb. Her light that shines out of her is not some deep revelation. It is the Lamb. It is the Lamb. And so here again, this is the one who's come. He's come to be the day spring on high, to enlighten us not to salvation, but to bring us back to the image that was lost in the beginning. The image that was lost. Now, we know that that wasn't the fullness of Christ then, but it was God's plan, and that was God. That's what's in his heart before sin. Let us make man in our own image. Let's go to Romans 7. Romans 7 and verse 14. So there's this wrestling that's going on before this, and it's the, you know, it's being exposed as the perverted image that we are. And that's the purpose of the law. The purpose of the law, because the law comes in to put you through the paces of that lamb shadow and says, okay, now you do it and you can't do it. See? And so it brings condemnation, but it also brings conviction. Conviction's not bad. It's not. We think it, oh no, you know, but it's not bad. If left to itself, it's not that good. But when conviction comes with a heart that wants the Lord, it is beautiful to him. You know, it is. All right, so this says, for we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. All right, so this freaks some people out. You know, I thought the law was the problem. Well, you know, if the law was a problem, God wouldn't have told Moses to give it to us. But he knew we were the problems, but he also knew we didn't know we were the problem. And I wonder if we still don't know. You know, I mean, you know what I'm saying. So he gives the law so that we can discover our need. Oh, wretched man that I am. We quit using methods and shadows and ethics and religion. Oh, wretched man that I am. Who? And that begins the eye-opening process, not of salvation, but of coming to light. Of coming to light. All right. Also, since we're here, Colossians 2:17. I don't mind going through the scripture, do you? Oh, good. This is a Bible school. Which are a shadow. I mean, okay, so let no man therefore judge you in food or drink or in respect of a feast day or of a new moon or of a Sabbath day. So we go, okay, that's right. That's right. Nobody's going to judge me in respect to what I eat. And this is what some people come away with this. You can say what you will, but I will not be judged. I will eat what I want. So I'm not going to be judged in respect to feast days or or food or drink or even the Sabbath, because I'm born again and I'm under grace. Clearly you're not under Lamb, dude. You see why I made this, I added this, because people who claim to be under grace are the most ungracious people you can meet. So, you know what I mean? They say stuff like that. I mean, we've had to deal with that through the Bible school for years, of people going, well, you know, all this is law. You're requiring me to, you know, you could almost say it like this. You're requiring me to love God a whole lot more. You know, or you're requiring me to love people I don't even like. Or you're cheating me out of doing things for others that's robbing me. See, you can stand there and boldly proclaim, I'm under grace without any condemnation. But the contrast really is the Lamb. The contrast is not supposed to be with others or with a system that has allowed you to run free, but with a Lamb who has allowed you to become a partaker of His image, of His nature. And that's the goal. And remember, the law is a poor reflection. But it's so poor that it's, on a larger scale, it's just darkness. It's darkness. All right. And then to realize that the law doesn't live. Any shadow you see, and here's what I was thinking about when I was thinking in relationship to this. A shadow can move. Because you move. A shadow can move, but it doesn't live. It doesn't live. Only the Lamb that casts that shadow lives. And you will be chastened shadows. This went on to say, it's not after a new moon or this or that, which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is Christ. And so this is the reality that He's wanting us to not be individuals trying to get our freedom to drink or to do this or to do that, but to be the body of Christ, which is not a shadow. And those things are. And even if you say, well, I drink this whiskey to the glory of God, it's still a shadow. Do you understand? I mean, it really is. I mean, you can go, well, at least I'm not like that guy. He just gets drunk to sit on his rear. But I buy my fifth of whiskey to the glory of God. And I have visions. I bet you do. All right, so in Hebrews it says that the law is a shadow of good things to come. Well, that good thing is Christ, because He's the one casting the shadow in the first place, but He needs to come. Yes. Come, Lord Jesus. You know, there has to be the coming of the Lord. There has to be the unveiling of the Lord. There has to be, and He has to be revealed. See, we know this. He has to be revealed in us. But may I say this? Please give me grace. Never mind, I don't know if I want to say it. Well, it's just this. It's very simple. Some look for the revelation of Christ, the coming of the Lord, Christ to be revealed in them, so that they know that it's Jesus in there, the life of Jesus. Jesus. But they don't know what nature that is. They just call it Christ in me. Say, well, why'd you say that? You shouldn't have said that. Well, you know, Jesus is in there. Okay, but Jesus is a Lamb. Amen? I mean, he is. He puts others first. He died for everybody. The big example. He died for everybody, but it didn't end there. And he goes, okay, I did this so everybody can be free and have grace. I did this so that my nature and my heart could be formed in you so that I would get one after my kind.
There you go.
See? And that's it. That's his heart and that's his desire. Bless you. Okay, so I'm just going to, well, let's go back to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. And starting in verse, let's see. Gosh, I think we should start in verse 13 here. I just think that there's something for us if we can see it, and it's not the way we normally see it. Okay. Verse 13. Now this is we're still talking about the law contrasted with his nature, with his image, with the Lamb, right? Isn't that what we're talking about? Okay. So this is Jesus speaking. You are the salt of the earth. You are the salt of the earth. You were meant to be the salt of the earth, but if the salt have lost its savor, with what shall it be salted? It is thereafter good for nothing but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. This is Jesus's first foray into appearing and preaching and sharing, and he knows the deal. You were meant to be the salt of the earth. You were meant to be that which gives savor to me in the earth. That's what you were meant for. You were meant for. But if you, this is Jesus talking. We go, yes, hallelujah, I'm the salt of the earth. That's what we usually walk off with. Praise God, I didn't know I was the salt of the earth. I guess I am, really, when I think about it. But he's saying to them, but if you've lost that image, then it's pretty much useless. He keeps talking. Verse 14. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden. So he's saying, you were meant to be the lantern through which my light shines. Because we're not the light of the world. Jesus said later, I am the light of the world. So we're going, well, should I fight him for that? You know, I'll wrestle you for it. Because you said I was. But we're like the candlestick in the tabernacle. We bear that light. But if we've got something put over him as light coming out of us, when he wanted to set us on a hill on Mount Zion, the glory of the whole earth, God said about it. How he loved Zion. Because you have to know his heart in that, or it's like the glory of the whole earth. Yeah, praise God. Great little hill. Never seen it, but I'm sure David thought it was pretty cool. That wasn't David talking. That was the Lord speaking in those Psalms. All right, so the Lord is again addressing a contrast with his image and nature and where we're at now when this is being shared. And maybe where we're at now in some cases, who knows? Neither do men light a lamp and put it under a bushel, but on a lampstand, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Unto all that are in the house. We're supposed to be shining this to everybody that's in the house of God. This is the light of the New Jerusalem, which is the wife of the Lamb. The Lamb is that. She's his wife. He's her light. But he wants to shine out of her. But if she's blocking that, you know, I mean, it would be a little bit like, have you ever done something silly like had a little dog or a cat or something like that, and you have a little basket and you set up on top of them and you watch them walk around like this and go, well, that could be us. But God's not laughing. God's not laughing. No, he's serious. But nonetheless, we put that over us and we go, okay, oh, the Lord wants me to go to church with a basket on us. And we come in and we sit down, you know. And the Lamb is not our light. And we are not salt that gives forth the savor of Christ. We've got that blocked with what? With a perverted image. With a perverted image. Now, you know and I know that you can believe that God wanted to make us in his image and that God sent Jesus and he died so that we'd have the image of Christ. All that's great, but the book of Revelation proves that some drastic things have to happen to finish off the work. And that work is started in the first chapter and moving all the way through until, bingo, there's one after his kind, the bride. She has his glory. She has him as light. She's become one in the truest sense. So, and then verse 16, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works. So we go, oh, good works, and glorify your Father who is in heaven. The good works are coming down from seed, from nature. You're the seed of the Father. You glorify him for this. You know, I could walk around going, you know, I got light blue eyes. I got baby blues, and I'm special because I just came up with them. Well, my mother has, these eyes, and they were passed down to Naphtali, and she passed them to Bryce, and you know, nobody along the line can you know say, you know, oh, I just came up with it. You didn't. That they may glorify your Father. Do you see my point? That this is coming from him, and so they're not just good works that I'm doing independently, or they would glorify you. Isn't that right? Think about it. All right. So Jesus is saying incredible stuff here. And yet, we read through once, you know, and then we spend 20 years before we read it again, and somebody says, hey, you want to study Matthew 5, 6, 7, you know, and we go, oh, no, I read that when I got saved. That stuff was easy. I want to get over there in Paul's stuff. But see, Jesus is not speaking of the process so much as his desire that we have savor of his image and that we shine his light out from, and that's what he meant for us and that's what he meant for himself. Yes. One after his kind again. Hallelujah. Made in his image. But see, it's hard to see that unless you see that. It's easy to just say, okay, well, I'm gonna let my light shine, so I'm gonna witness to people at work. I mean, and that's what we get out of it. He's saying, oh, glorify the Father. Glorify God with this stuff, not just put a notch on your belt. That's the fifth person I've won this year to Jesus, and woo! You know, some sort of gloating and glory, glorify myself. When's the last time you won anyone to the Lord? Well, I won someone 2 months ago. Well, first of all, really? Did you win them? And can you glory in that? Can you glory in that? Or can you give him glory that he did that? Because just like healing, I don't know how to save anybody. I mean, if I did, honestly, I'd be talking to everybody constantly. But maybe some of you didn't realize. I didn't realize when I first got saved. When I first got saved, I just wanted to talk to everybody about Jesus and everything. And, you know, some people go, yeah, and receive the Lord. And some people just got mad and stuff. And I remember very early, Deb and I were married, and we were going door to door. And we were part of Shiloh, and I was assistant pastor. And we were asked if we would canvass the city of Denton. And so I got me a chart of the streets, a layout of the streets. And I marked them off into squares. And I said, we're going to go to every door in Denton. And I got Deb, and who do we have, Naf? Was it? Naf till I was in the stroller. And we'd walk up and knock on doors, and I'd usually do most of the talking and everything. And sometimes I'd walk up on my own, you know. With Naphtali there, you'd be surprised how many doors would open wide, you know what I mean? But I also, and we basically covered Denton. We literally walked to every house and knocked on the door. I'm not joking. I do remember when Deb goes, well, can I try? You know, this is very early in our walk with the Lord. Can I try? And I said, sure. So she walks up to the door and knocks. This guy comes in. She starts talking about Jesus. I guess this guy was a Satan worshiper or something. He railed on her and went all, and then slammed the door in her face. And she walks over and goes, what did I do wrong? I said, I think it was him. I'm pretty sure he wasn't ready. And may never be. But nonetheless, we tried. Praise God. All right, so let me just read this. Actually, let's go on to verse 17. Think not that I am come to destroy the law, there it is, or the prophets. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill. Isn't that cool? That destroy might end up being the result in somewhere found in the heart of the book of Revelation. But fulfill, that's no longer looking at the shadow being all these different things of being kind and not stealing and doing stuff like that. But the Lamb nature, the light shining on the Lamb, and now we're in a position to see the light shining on him, and as it were, he shining as the fulfillment of that. And I wrote here, you're either one who is required to keep the law or one who allows Christ in them to fulfill the law. The righteousness of the law is not done away. Under the old covenant, you're required to do it. But under the new covenant, Christ will be it in you. Okay, so there's your contrast of our nature to his. The contrast is my image, no matter how much I could look in the mirror and say, you know, I like me, it's a perverted image of what God meant. I mean, there's things that they're hard sometimes. You have to come to this place where it is, oh, wretched man that I am. I'm done with me. And I'm going to embrace the cross in a manner that's actually going to do something. I'm tired of believing about the Lamb, and I want him to live in me. But more than that, because it can't just be about you being sick of it. He wanted this in the first place, and I want, for his sake, I want to give him what he wanted in the very beginning before man fell and perverted that image. Okay, so, and here's the deal. The truth is, you're never going to get to that image until you come to him in that spirit. You know, you can learn a lot about the cross. You can even drop some things. But the image is Him. You see, so there has to be a heart in there. It can't just be, this is just another version of me saving myself from hell. But that when I got saved, it was save myself from hell and punishment. Here, it saved myself from how bad I look. I don't like looking bad. Anybody like looking bad? Well, get used to it. You and I are a perverted image of what was meant. And if we can settle that, I mean, that's what Romans 7 is all about. Romans 7 is drastic. It's bringing us down to a place where we see our absolute corruptness to the core and crying out for the Lord. Crying out for the Lord, not as a person who's unsaved, but as a person who has come to the conclusion that no matter how good I think I am, God is not pleased because it's a corrupt image. So what will please His heart? What will please His heart? Now, you know, this was all done. Remember, Paul writes about in Ephesians, for the good pleasure of the Lord. I mean, have you ever thought of that verse, you know? The good pleasure of the Lord? You got to kind of, you know, put those words in a basket and shake them around and pull it up and go, the good pleasure. That he could have said that the holy God would be satisfied with the sacrifice. He said the good pleasure of the Lord. The good pleasure of the Lord. The word pleasure. That's not a word we use a lot. Especially with God. You know, and we think if we use it in relationship to us, well, it's sin or something. Well, that's ridiculous too. God, believe it or not, it comes from the word pleasing. God pleases us all the time. He blesses us and takes care of us and stuff. But you see, most of the time, at a certain juncture, two of my daughters started leading worship, and they started getting kind of good at it and stuff, but they had really cheesy guitars. And so I was sitting there, and one Christmas was coming up, and I had two guitars, great acoustic guitars. One was a Gibson, and one was a Guild, and they were the only acoustic guitars I had. But they were really, really good ones. They're worth quite a bit now particularly. So that Christmas, I decided what would really please them is if I gave them my guitars. And they grew up with them, little kids, and I'm sitting there playing in front of them. So we had our Christmas and stuff, and it looked like it was over. And I said, wait a minute. I went out, and I walked in, and I sat. I knew who liked which guitar. And I sat in front of them, and I said, Merry Christmas. And they said, what? What? You know? It touched them in a place that, you know, even to this day, I mean, even the trips that I've made recently, whether Guatemala or down to Arizona or whatever, the subject has come up of those guitars. And I think, when Jason was here, that's what it was. Jason said, yeah, we were talking about getting Niecy's guitar fixed, so we got it set up again, got it aligned and new strings put on it, and it's just great. And Jason said, and I said to her, how much do you think this thing is worth? And she said, don't even think that way. Yeah, he wanted to buy it. And then she had the Gibson. And she's going, I wouldn't sell this for all the money in the world. Okay. All right. That's what we're trying to do there is an example. And you know, the interesting thing was, for a long time after that, I had to go without an acoustic guitar. Never in my whole life, almost, had I been without an acoustic guitar. It was weird. It was like, what did I do with these? I don't know what to do now. It really was weird. You know how much Mike Gentry is such a precious brother. So he comes, he's feeling me, you know, I feel you, brother. So he comes walking in and he gives me a white Samick acoustic guitar and a white one with some Marxalots that I can ride on it because he knows I'm weird. And I'm going, Mike, I love you, but you know, I'll just trust the Lord to get there. Anyway, I received his heart. But there are, see, maybe Naphtali, I would never have particularly liked having a guitar. Maybe there was something else in her heart that, there's certain things that touch people. Do you agree? There's certain things, but if you don't know what they are, you know, you remember a couple of classes ago, I was talking about men and women's relationship, and a guy goes, okay, I'm going to get her candy and flowers, and that's fine. Every girl should get candy and flowers at some time in their life, but you shouldn't assume that that's the top thing in the world they want, nor a vacuum cleaner. Well, you know what I'm saying, or a toaster. I'm just telling you, they actually like stuff and you never notice it as a guy because they're so busy taking care of you. Anyway, so my point is that there are things deep within us that can be fulfilled. Well, God's the same way. The good pleasure of the Lord. We read that, but we have no clue what that is. But it is that sweet savor of sacrifice that could come out of us and be after his kind and think like he does. Let this mind be in you. Don't fight it. Don't look at it as evil. Bring him pleasure and let this mind be in you. But we're just trying to be a Christian. Okay, well, I'm going to lay down my life. Well, I'm going to give this and, you know, I know the Lord's going to go, well, that was really nice of you. Good job. It's more than that to him. It's much more than that. And so we just go right on by and he's going, and then we walk off. And he goes, I want to share that with somebody. You know, anybody ever, you know, anybody married here and you went somewhere like, you know, I've made a lot of trips to different countries, Costa Rica or something like that, and you're sitting there on a beach and there's palm trees and all of this, and you know, Deb's back here and you go, gosh, I wish, you know, you think, I wish so-and-so was with me so that we could enjoy this together. Well, there's a spirit and a heart that comes out of oneness that can't be described. You can't describe it, so it's really ridiculous for me to even try to describe that. It's also ridiculous for me to try to describe the joy and the pleasure that he gets out of certain things and the kind of oneness it will take to bring that about. The kind of oneness. Because I believe we have a distorted view of oneness with Christ. I do. I really believe that. You know. All right. So, what time is it? Well, we're still about 10 minutes out. Sure, we got this. Okay, so Jesus is saying in verse 18, we're still in Matthew 5, for verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or tittle shall in no wise or way pass from the law till all be fulfilled, not kept. You can't do that by trying to look at the shadow, the laws of shadow, and trying to do that. You only get that by looking at the Lamb that is supposed that will one day, as it were, be your husband. I'm just saying it like that. Because we're so foreign. We're a foreign woman. We look at that and we go, okay, well, I was a sinner, but now I'm going to do this, so I'm really pleasing God, you know, not realizing we're still a foreign woman. And so I'm going to do all this stuff, and I'm going to please God with that. And that doesn't please him. By the law is no man justified before the Lord. But then something happens to you. And you get a glimpse of him, not just what he did that blessed you. You see a different kind of heart. You see a different kind of creature. You look at that one, and if you could imagine that, you wouldn't say this because you're still looking at him going, oh, I wish I could be like Jesus. Or maybe you've come to the place where you go, you're looking at that lamb, you go, oh, I wish I could have the lamb formed in me. See, he's got other things on his mind. And if she could look at him and go, one day, that lamb's going to be my husband. That's who I'm going to marry. That's my husband right there. You know, you understand the spirit. We get messed up with gender. Well, am I transgender? What bathroom do I use? Since I'm the bride and yet I'm a son of God. You've confused me as to which restrooms I should go to now, Randy. Anyway. So, but you know, people do. They get mixed up in that. I can look at that lamb and go, I want him to be my head. I want to love that. I want to love him. I don't just want him to be in me. And so I show forth that, and the Father goes, that's it. You know, I want to love that. I believe, and here's the key. I believe that that lamb loves me, but not just to save me from hell. That he loves me, that he loves you, that everything from start to finish, all the way through till it's fulfilled, till all be fulfilled, was towards that end. That the Spirit has so worked with her that she's saying the same thing, and it's saying, come. You know. And it's just, it is beauty beyond words, and it is beauty beyond any scope of our mental capacities to get that. So on that hand, again, it's ridiculous to teach, but it is not ridiculous to plant seeds. If you believe in that, then you plant seeds and you say, I trust now the Holy Spirit, and this has nothing to do with me, and I'm not trying to declare anything of myself, but his heart, and to know him from the inside out. I mean, that was the whole deal with the sacrifice. They didn't just take a lamb. They opened him up and they had to hold up the different parts of him to the Lord and say, look, I see this part. I see the inward parts, and then hold up this part and hold it as holy before the Lord. And I see it. I hold it in my being. I understand him on the inside. And it's the highest that I could do. And God says, I'm blessed with this. I'm blessed with this. Because you see the crucified lamb from the inside out. And that's a work of the Holy Spirit to bring us to see that. But we can know the scriptures that's what the high priest or the priest did, you know, and went through that and go, oh, that's really deep. But that still doesn't get it, does it? That still doesn't release his heart to us to such a way that this is now not. There's no thought of Christianity in that. I know that sounds weird. There's only him. Anybody know something about, this Mary Bethany chick? Anybody know anything about her? You know? I believe that that was a memorial to him. And I believe that it was because she had one focus, and it wasn't, I'm going to do this so that everybody will notice and God will make a memorial to me. I am sure of it. I'm sure there was no thought of what she was going to get out of it. And probably she, knowing she's going into a Pharisee's house and a bunch of disciples may not like it, that it may go bad. But she didn't care. And she passed through the veil, as it were. She entered into where it was just him. And she released something that communicated to his heart, I get it. I know you. I think that I really understand you, O Lamb of God. Jesus says, she did it for my burial. She understands I'm a Lamb of God. She understands my spirit and my nature and everything. You know, this is it. She's getting something that is worldwide and forever. That I always meant, that I always had in my heart. And she's addressing that without words, because it is spiritual. The law is not words, it's spiritual. She's addressing it and fulfilling it. And I can you imagine? And I'm touched in ways that I can't tell anybody. I can just say, let her alone. You don't even understand. You should be beyond this, but let her alone. Don't interject yourself into this moment. That's his heart. See, let Jesus, you know, if we're that rank or that off or that whatever, let's just bow out and say, look, we're going to leave. We don't deserve to be in the Holy of Holies with what's going on here. We'll wait for you out here in the holy place. Does that make sense at all? I mean, it's almost because all they were doing was corrupting it with thoughts that had nothing to do with that. We don't understand that to the depth, but we know you well enough to know this is a big deal to you. We'll wait outside. And then I would, if I did that, I'd be outside and I'd be praying, Oh Father. That the delight that she brought him, that you could work that in me, not for me, but for his sake. That you could do that. If you could do that, that would be so wonderful. That would be so wonderful. That I wouldn't have all this corruption in what I do and what I say. And when I say all this corruption, it may be, you know, and I'm sorry, we're running over just a little bit, but it would be, you know, the example of, you know, go get me a cold glass of water. Most of you remember this. So you bring a cold glass of water and you're so thirsty and everything. And then the person who brings it takes a toothpick, sticks it in manure, and then just sticks it in there and pulls it out and says, here. And you go, I ain't drinking that. It's okay. It's ever so small. It's ever so small. It'll be okay. That's what we do to Jesus. And we think, well, you know, I don't have hardly any corruption at all. But even the slightest, we want to, it's like, you know, moving water purifies, amen? Out of our innermost being shall flow rivers of living water. And that comes from union with him in such a way that he's seen and he's the light and he's the temple and he's all to you and he's in you and he's enthroned, but he's still a slaughtered lamb. And that's my husband right there. And I love him. I love him with all my heart. So, I'm fulfilling the first commandment. No, you're not even thinking about commandment. Amen? I love him with everything. I love that spirit. I love that nature. I love that person. I love that being. I love you. And I will ever pursue you. You're my hope. You're my dream. You're my desire. And when you're there, it'll just carry you. It's not perfect. It just carries you, though, because there's an attraction. You know about attraction. There's an attraction. You feel drawn. I'd like to be with him. Anybody know what that's like? You know, I'd like to be with him. You know, I'm sitting here alone. I'd like to be with him. So, Holy Spirit, bring it on. Pick up your Bible. Amen. All right, let's take a break.